us for the first time, we just want to acknowledge you and say that we appreciate you joining us today. We want to take a moment to share with you the mission of Growing Faith. It's directly to my left on this green banner, and it says that Growing Faith exists to lead people searching for more into a thriving relationship with Jesus. And I love that word, thrive. You know, thrive means that something is growing and that it's growing well. And so when I think about the word thrive, I think about my bank account. I like a thriving bank account. I think about health and relationships and all areas of life. I want to thrive. And so our mission is to lead people that are searching for more into a thriving, growing, healthy relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We want to share today's scripture with you that you'll hear a little bit more about later as the sermon is presented. It's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, and it reads, Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price, so glorify God in your body. Wow, that is a power-packed scripture, and we definitely will hear more about that in our service later today. At this time, we want to go ahead and invite Ms. Jawana to come up, and she just has something that she wants to share with us of what God has done for her.
Can you hear me? Okay. Well, good morning, everybody. Just wanted to share a testimony with you guys today. So first, giving honor to God, Pastor T, First Lady Cindy, and the Growing Faith family. So I just wanted to share that last year I applied for the Public Student Loan Forgiveness Program. So I applied for the program in September of last year, got an email notification that I did not qualify for the Student Loan Forgiveness Program. But I forgot about it. I didn't even worry about it. So as I checked my mail a few weeks ago, it was two refund checks in there. Two refund checks. And I said, okay, Lord, I mean, what is this? So I opened them, and when I opened it, on the back of it, it said Fed loan refund. And so my eyes are filling up with tears. So I'm like, let me go check my student loan login. So I go log in, and there's a letter in there that says, thank you for your service. Wiped out the incomplete balance, so the balance was zero. Wow. So I just want to share that God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above whatever we can even ask or think. So I just wanted to share that God is Jehovah Jireh. He will provide, and that God is faithful, that he's a good God, and that he does not fall short. We do, but God doesn't. And so I just want to leave this scripture with you today. And it says from 2 Peter 3 and 9, it says, the Lord does not delay, as though we were as though he was unable to cancel. And it says, and is not slow about his promises, as some count slowness, but is extraordinarily patient towards you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. Yeah. So if you have what promises do you have from God today? What promises have you been waiting on him to fulfill? You just keep the faith and trust that God will do what God only can.
Amen. Praise God. Come on, somebody shout, me too, Lord. Me too. Amen. Come on, cancel those loans and debts in Jesus' name. Praise God. Hallelujah. Such a beautiful testimony. Amen. God bless you, Jawana. We appreciate that today. Amen. Again, a pleasant good morning to each of you today. Again, to those of you joining us online, we want to say we're happy that you're here. Welcome, welcome. Amen. Praise God. I'm going to be up here today doing some announcements with my wife. Praise God. Amen. So you could take it away, honey.
Praise God. We just wanted to share a few announcements with you this morning that are coming up for the week and for the month. The first of which, we will have our membership 101 class. So we announced this last week, mm-hmm. and we want to go ahead and just keep that before you. So this is the first of our series for our membership classes. Mm-hmm. We are asking everyone to go through this class, even if you've been with Growing Faith for however many number of years. Mm-hmm. We want everybody to go back through this class. So mm-hmm. this is going to be on July the 23rd, so that's exactly 2 weeks from today. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be immediately following service. And again, it's just taking a deeper dive into who Growing Faith is, what is Growing Faith all about, and then how does Growing Faith play a small part in the body of Christ, mm-hmm. in the big ecclesia of the church.
Amen.
And so we just want to invite you to participate in that. Please do let us know that you intend to come so that we make sure that we have enough food and refreshments for everyone. And you
Amen.
Can see myself for that further information or to RSVP.
Amen. Praise God. This month, we are doing something. Somebody shall do something.
Do something.
Amen. This month, we are collecting hygiene items. If you didn't know, one of our values as a faith community is resource community. It's been said that people change when they hurt enough that they have to, that they learn enough that they want to, but that they receive enough that they are able to. There's a lot of people out there in our world right now don't have resources, don't have the things that they need in order for them to change. And so one of our values is to resource community and to help with that. And so we want to make sure that we're ready and able to respond when a need exists, when a need arises, so that we can address needs. And one of those things being hygiene items. And it may sound like something that it's just like, oh, it's just not a big deal. But you'd be surprised how many people have to make a decision between whether they're going to eat, pay their light bill, pay their mortgage or rent, or have hygiene items. You'd be so surprised. And so as a faith community, we're in a position where we're not being reactive, but we are, come on, help me, we're being proactive. Amen.
Somebody say movie day.
Movie day.
We have a family movie day coming up Saturday of this week, mm-hmm. so just 6 days from today. Mm-hmm. Doors will open at
6:30 p.m. Yes.
And the movie will start at 7. And this mm-hmm. is going to be a faith-based movie. Mm-hmm. It's for the whole family to
yes.
come and enjoy. If you haven't already, you will receive a text message that asks you to RSVP if you're coming.
Mm-hmm.
And to let us know so that we have enough refreshments for everyone. This is completely free. And so we just want to make sure that we have enough for everyone and that
yes.
we're able to fellowship.
That's going to be so much fun.
It is.
And it's going to be right here. So be sure to come out. Get you some popcorn, some Rice Krispie treats, some candy, whatever. And all of the concessions are at no cost. Notice I didn't say free. Amen. There's a difference. Free means it's just free. At no cost means that you don't have to pay for it. Means somebody else paid for it. Come on, somebody. Amen.
Amen. We're so excited. We have our Healthy Marriage Retreat coming up
yes.
Just shy of 3 weeks from today. So we are super excited
yes.
about this. All married couples, you are invited to participate. Mm-hmm. We're going to be going out to Jordan Ranch in Schulenburg, Texas. Beautiful campus there, beautiful grounds. And we're just going to enjoy the nature of God, some beautiful scenery, some very good food.
Yes.
And we're going to enjoy being able to be strengthened in our marriages with the, mm-hmm. the information that we'll receive. So that is coming up the last weekend of this month. So it's Thursday, July 27th through Saturday, July 29th. You can mm-hmm. register on our website, see myself if you need any information.
I love it. Looking forward to that. And finally, we want to thank each of you. You know, one of the things that we realize is that in order for us to do the work that God has called us to do, we need resources. We need funds to do that. And because of your generosity, we're able to do it. And so we have five different ways that you can give. There's in person. There's, of course, offering envelopes on the seat back cushion of your seat. And also you can give online, and all of the different ways to give are online. And so we just want to say on behalf of Growing Faith and the entire ministry, we appreciate all of your generosity. Amen?
Amen.
So give yourselves a hand clap for that. We appreciate each of you. And so we want to take a moment and go around and greet one another. You know, one of the things, the word fellowship is not in our name on accident. The word fellowship means partnership. It means equal contribution and consumption, right? So a lot of times people come to consume when they come to a faith community, but it's not just about consuming, it's about contributing. And so we just want you to know how much we appreciate each of you for what you, not only what you receive, but also what you bring. And so we have a little moment of fellowship. We're gonna take about 5 minutes and greet one another and get you some donuts and coffee or whatnot. So God bless you.
Shout it out one more time. I'm expecting great things. expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. Great things.
That's real simple right there. Can you help me declare it over your life? Say,
I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. Great things. In my life.
Good morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. All right. We're going to go ahead and, oh, yes. My wife is reminding me that for our kids, As an alternative for you, make sure you get your clipboard so that you can keep up with the sermon this morning. We call it a sermon scavenger hunt. So praise God. Amen. Well, we're going to go ahead and get started. We want to invite everyone inside to come on in and let's get ready for the word this morning. Praise God. Amen. Good morning to you. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Well, let's just let's open in a word of prayer. Good morning, my brother. Good morning. How you doing? Oh, you can go ahead. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good morning, little people. Good morning. Praise God. Amen. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we're so grateful, so thankful for the opportunity to give you glory and honor and praise. We realize, God, that it's not by our own strength, our own power that we're here today. It's because of your grace and your mercy. And so, Lord, this morning, we just come and we surrender our will to you, Father. We say, have your way. Holy Spirit, would you speak this morning? Would you minister to every need that exists in this place today? Lord, I don't know what all is needed. I don't know who needs to be encouraged. I don't know what word they need to hear today, Father, but you do. And so I pray that I would decrease. Lord, that you would increase. Speak through me. Minister to every need today in the building. Lord, and those of us that are online today, I pray that you would reach every person that's online today in Jesus' name. Lord, and I just give you praise, Lord. We just for a moment, God, we just say thank you. You've been so good to us, Lord. You've been so good to us, God. And so this morning we thank you. Father, we pray for all of our family that's out traveling this week. We pray, God, for your traveling grace upon each person, Lord. Every person today, Father, who's on vacation, and God, we just ask, would you use this time to rebuild us, strengthen us, Lord, in this season, Lord. And God, so we thank you today. We bless you. We give you praise, all the glory and honor today. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, somebody give God a shout of praise this morning. He's worthy to be praised. So good to see each of you today. So grateful to be here today. Praise God. Would you just do me a favor? Just kind of look around the room, wave at someone and tell them, just tell them, it's just so good to see you. Praise God. Amen. So good to see you. Praise God. Amen. I hear you, Brother Robert. Brother Robert says it's good to be seen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. And children, I just want to celebrate you just for a moment, children, and let you know that you have been a trooper. Can y'all give it up for our children today? Y'all have been a trooper. I know that you had to have come and sit in the adult service, and you're like, man, we don't have children's church. And right now, children's church there's a little bit of a season of break right now. And so we wanted to give our teachers a break during this season. And at the same time, we wanted to still keep our kids engaged. And so we are really thankful for the fact that you have some tools to help you to pay attention in service. Praise God. Amen. Well, I don't want to prolong the time. I want to get right into the word today. So grateful for the opportunity to share the word of God with you today. I want to open with this really cool quote. It says, the body is meant to be a servant, not a master. We are called to discipline and train it so that it becomes an instrument for righteousness and a vessel for God's glory. I think that is so good. And, you know, today I want to talk to you from the idea of extreme home makeover. Extreme home makeover. Over the last several months, my wife and I have participated in an opportunity of serving children by allowing them to be in our home and providing respite for foster parents. And it has been truly an amazing experience. I'm a grown man, y'all. I'm 46. Many of my colleagues are counterparts that are my age, they have grandkids. And so having a 7-year-old and a 4-year-old truly has been a humbling experience for me, to say the least. And something that I have discovered is when children are in the home, they make a difference. Their presence is known when they're in the home. It's so funny because when we have people come over to our house because there are no kids there, a lot of times people say, oh my gosh, should I take my shoes off? Or, oh my gosh, it just feels so clean in here. And people are like, man, it's just so quiet in here. Well, I never understood why they had that response until we had a couple of young boys come over. And from the moment they hit the door, it's on and popping. Amen. A lot of times, we know something's wrong when it's too quiet. Amen. But when it's quiet, we're like, let me go see what they're doing. And sure enough, you go in there and they're into something they shouldn't be into. But my point is that children's presence makes a difference. And I want you to know that this is also true about God. His presence makes a difference. And it's my conviction today that God wants to do an extreme home makeover on us, our temple. See, one of the things that we're going to discover as we study the scriptures today is that we are actually God's house. We are God's home. And I love the way evangelist Robert put it this morning, that God could have chosen to live anywhere in the universe, yet he chose to live within these earthen vessels. And so what I hope that you hear today is that God's presence makes a difference. When God lives on the inside of us, you'll know the difference. So today is the conclusion of our sermon series that we've been in, The Heart of Worship. And we've talked about how in worship that God wants us to worship him with the totality of who we are. And we've talked about how this year, we wanted this year to be the year of maximized potential. And we framed that into two things, that we would give God our very best, that's considered commitment, and that we would make the most of what we have, that's stewardship. And so we've talked about how we want you to steward well your time, your talent, your treasure, your team, and your temple. Well, today, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about stewarding well our temples, these bodies, and stewarding them well is an expression or an act of worship. Are you with me this morning? Praise God. So our sermon series objective has been to move believers to daily reflection. We hope that as we have been teaching in this series, is that you would be moved to daily reflection on God's worth and in response, worship him with the totality of who you are. That worship is not a segment of a church service. Okay, we're about to have worship. No, that I would see worship as something that I do all the time. Amen. Praise God. So when we talk about what is worship, it's the recognition of and the response to God's worth. We have claimed that worship is a lifestyle. Praise God. So what we're talking about today is how do we worship God with these bodies? How do we steward well these temples? Well, I believe that one of the issues that we oftentimes come up against is that one of the challenges of us using our temples to worship God with our bodies is that we are often enslaved by the passions of our flesh. Can I hear the saints this morning declare, I am not a slave to my flesh? Yes, I don't know about you, but there have been times in my life where I have felt like I could not help myself. Have you ever said those words? I just couldn't help myself. Lay's potato chip said it this way, that if you eat one chip, You can't eat just one because you're just going to keep going and going. And I don't know about you, but I said, let me open this little bag of chips and I'm just going to get a couple, put it on the plate, take me a couple, and that's going to be it. Before I knew it, the bag of chips is gone. I guess I'm not the only one. Praise God. So when we talk about being enslaved to the passions of our flesh, the result is misuse and abuse of our bodies. Now, can I say something to the parents today? Usually, we wouldn't have our kids in here today, and so we could just speak freely, and there wouldn't be any discomfort. Well, I'm just going to just be honest with you today. Have you ever, parents, taken your kids to a movie, and they watched the movie, and there was stuff in the movie that you're just like, oh, my gosh, I didn't realize this was in the movie. I'm going to have to talk to the kids about it when we get home. That's the kind of message this is going to be. Y'all are going to, this is a rated R message. I'm just going to be honest with you. Like, golly, this is rated R. I got my kids up in here, so I'm just forewarning you. Children, I'm not going to have any trouble at all today with the kids listening. Because you ever notice the kids don't ever pay attention to stuff that they're supposed to pay attention to. They pay attention to the stuff that they're not supposed to be, right? They miss everything else but the bass that they glued into, right? Well, that's today. Amen. Praise God. So we're talking about how do we steward these bodies, right? So when we talk about the passions of our flesh, when we are under the control or under the power of our flesh, it results in misuse of the body. One of the ways that we misuse these bodies, we abuse these bodies, is that we overeat. Am I the only one that have dealt with that, deal with that, wrestle with that battle of the bulge? Amen. The Bible refers to that as gluttony. Gluttony is not just a term that's in the scriptures. Gluttony is actually considered sin. Right? All right. Another way is that we abuse substances. We drink alcohol. We overdo it. Right? And drinking alcohol, let me just say, according to the Bible, is not sinful, but it is the overuse of alcohol that becomes a problem. Amen. And for some of us, the Holy Spirit has just downright said, you just can't drink alcohol at all because you just can't help yourself. You can't just have, okay, I'm just going to, praise God. All right. Another area is laziness, right? The Bible refers to that as slothfulness, right? Okay. So when we talk about how do we often abuse our bodies, these are three critical common ways that we abuse our bodies, and we shouldn't, because this is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And finally, one of the ways that we do this, that we abuse our bodies, that we're going to talk about today, but I want to say this is not what it's all about, but this is definitely the subject matter, and that is sexual immorality. Dum, 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 dum. I told you, parents. Here we go. We're about to get into some of the deep waters. But I'm so glad that the children are here, because as I considered, I said, well, Lord, maybe we'll take the kids and we'll put them in the back. We don't want them in here to hear this subject matter. And this is what the Spirit said. He said, we talk about sex in every other arena other than the church. Am I right about it? So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about it. We're going to get into it. So here's what the idea is today. Here's what we're talking about today. Here's what I hope that you hear today. Our body was not designed solely for our pleasure, but should be devoted to God's purposes. That's what our bodies are for. And I hope, it is my aim, that at some point today, what will click for each of us today is that we'll realize that, yes, God designed our bodies to have pleasure. We enjoy pleasure when we have food that we eat. We get pleasure from having sex with our spouses. We get pleasure from all of these different things. But that's not the only reason for our bodies. The other reason, the main reason for our bodies, is that it would be devoted for what? God's purposes. And a lot of times our bodies are broken down because we aren't caring for them, and so we are tired, and so we aren't good vessels to be used by God. Praise God. All right, so this is what I hope that you hear today. So here's the question that I'm going to be navigating for the rest of our time. How do we present our body for God's purposes? That's what I want to ask today. How do I present my body for God's purposes? Well, I'm so glad you asked. The first way is this. We must see ourselves as sacred. Come on, say that with me. I must see myself as sacred. Yes, I must see myself as sacred. When I was growing up, one of the things that I learned was to treat the sanctuary of God as sacred. I was. Anybody know anything about that, right? Back in the day, when you came to church, you couldn't just come in and bring anything into church with you. You couldn't bring drinks, or you couldn't come in there chewing gum. You know, y'all remember the old ushers? You walked in chewing gum, and they would let you spit it in there. You didn't play with the sanctuary, right? Y'all remember the song, "We lift our hands in the sanctuary." Come on, saints. Come on. To give you the glory. Y'all sound good. To give you the praise, and we will praise you for the rest of our days. Yes, come on. Come on, yeah. Y'all sounding good. Yes, Lord. Oftentimes we've reserved those types of songs and worship for what we call church. When in reality, God says we have more respect for a building than we do our bodies. So what God is calling us to today is that we realize our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. So I must view myself as sacred. When I was growing up as a young man, one of the ways that my mother helped me to appreciate my sexuality is that she didn't just treat me like, oh, he's just a boy, he's just going to do it. No, she was like, you should have enough respect for your body not to just give your body to anybody. Is that good teaching? When I went to college and this young lady told me, listen, I know you have a girlfriend and I don't want nothing from you, but I just want your body. That did not appeal to me. I thought that was nasty. Why? Because I had this sense of value and respect for my sexuality. Now, I'm not going to lie to you. It ain't always been that way. There have been some times I've been like, use me. Until you use me up. Oh, come on. Y'all know about that. Right? So we must understand that we have to see ourselves as what? I got to see myself as sacred, right? See, if I'm going to present my body for God's purposes, I must see myself as sacred. You can't just use my body the way you want. And we're going to get into why, what happens when we give our bodies over and how it creates this defiling of our temple. Amen. So when we talk about what is sacred, to be sacred means to be set apart and dedicated for God's purposes. That's what it is to be sacred. So when God says, I want you to be sacred, I want you to know, he says, I want you to set yourself apart. So the context of our scripture this morning is the writer Paul writes a letter to the church at Corinth, and he's dealing with sexual immorality. Many times in the letters of Paul, he's dealing with issues within the church. And it was reported to Paul that there was a man who was having sex with his father's wife. And this is what Paul says. It's not even named among Gentiles. It's not named among people who aren't followers of Jesus to do something like that. And so he was addressing this issue, and he was saying that that is a problem. And this is what he says. He says, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? In other words, the Holy Spirit is living within you. So if the Holy Spirit is living within you, that means that what's happening is that you have actually took the Holy Spirit with you and doing the things that you shouldn't be doing. It reminds me of this one time, Cindy and I, we went on a cruise. And as I was out on this cruise, I remember thinking to myself, I wonder if I could just leave the Holy Spirit in my cruise room. Because on a cruise ship, can I tell you about it? You don't have to go looking for trouble. Trouble comes looking for you. You don't have to go and say, let me go try to see if I can get into something. It'll come. It's laid out on a menu. It literally has a description of everything you want to do. And so I thought to myself, well, I can go and participate in this. But if I go and participate in this, I'm going to feel conviction. And so what I would love is for me to be able to just leave the Holy Spirit in my room so I don't have to worry about this little voice telling me you shouldn't be doing that. But it doesn't work like that. I can't take off the Holy Spirit. So the only thing that's going to happen is that if I take him with me into this, what I'm going to do is do what the Bible calls as grieve the Spirit. I'm going to cause grief because what I'm doing is that I am taking the body that belongs to the Lord and I am abusing it. So this is why Paul teaches us that you must see yourself as sacred. He says, because do you not know that your body, come on, do this with me. Say, my body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. That's right. Now watch this. I want you to notice something. I like the way Nancy Piercy said it. She said, to steward our bodies means to treat them with, what's this word? Reverence. To nourish them wisely, to rest them sufficiently, to care for them diligently, and to offer them as instruments for God's work in the world. This is what my body is for. Right? It is to be devoted to God. Now, I like the way the psalmist says it. The psalmist teaches us this, Joanna. The psalmist says, for you formed my inward parts. God formed you. Say that with me. God formed me. God formed you. He says this, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. Can I tell you a secret? I don't care what your mama and daddy intended when they laid down to make you. They may not have intended to make you. You just might have been the result of some kind of passion. But can I tell you a secret? You might be a surprise. You may have been an accident, but not in the eyes of God. God had a plan for you. God created you with the intent for a purpose. You were not some random accident. You were created for a purpose. And notice what he says, you knitted me together. In other words, this suggests that there was a strategic, it was a design, it wasn't like, you know how you make something and you made it and you didn't intend to make it, right? Like post-it notes. Post-it notes was something that was an accident. It was an accident that was made by somebody who didn't intend to make it. But when it comes to you, God intended to make you. I always like to tell people, people will say things like this. I was born that way. I was born, however. I was born gay. I'm going to use that one. I was born gay. Is this too deep for anybody today? No. I was born gay. And here's what I always like to say to that. You may have been born gay. Because the scripture says you were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. I wasn't born gay, but you know what I was born? How I was born? I was born mannish. Y'all know anything about mannish? That means when I was 3 and 4, I was looking at girls like, oh, yeah, I like that. I don't know what about it I like, but I like that. I remember that as a 3-4-year-old. But here's what you must understand. I wasn't made that way. There's a difference between how you were born and how you were made. How you were made speaks to God's intentional design for you. And notice what we see. It says, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you for how am I made? I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I've been trying to hold it together, but I can't do it anymore. I see these little boys back here playing, and I want them in here hearing this. Y'all come on in the service. Come on. Yep, that's the pastor in me. Come on. Y'all in there having a good old time. This is not children's church today. Y'all come on. I want y'all in here. Come on. Hustle up. And I want y'all to sit here and listen to the word. Nope, not over there. Come on, sit on over here in the chair. Come on. I want you up here. I wanted you listening. Because I'm going to tell you something about the enemy when it comes to our children. The enemy has been attempting to put things in our children about their sexuality. Am I telling the truth this morning? Amen. Put things in us, put before us. Like, you can't just anymore just turn the TV on and just let kids watch TV because they got all kinds of agendas going on through the children's network. But anyway, hey, children, glad you can join us this morning. I would recap, but you may have to go back and watch it later. Amen. So here it is. So we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Come on, shout this with me. I am a masterpiece. That's right. I am not an accident. I am a masterpiece. Praise God. So notice what in 2 Timothy, what we find. The scripture says, now in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some of honorable use, some for dishonorable. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself, somebody shall cleanse himself. Cleanses himself from what is what? Dishonorable. He will be a vessel for honorable use. Now, you see how the mic start popping when you start talking about this kind of stuff? Let me tell you a secret. I didn't come here to play no games today. Come on, I didn't come to play games today because what we're talking about is very important. It's critical because we must understand that these bodies that God has given to us, he's given them to us to steward. That means that if I am a steward, that means I'm not an owner. This is not my body. This is not your body. You belong to God. Amen. So here it is. He says, for dishonorable, he will be a vessel for honorable use. How many of you today want to be a vessel for honorable use? Amen. If you're online today, go and drop us a hand emoji, right? When I was growing up, my grandmother had this curio set. After we got home from church, we would eat off these paper plates or these common plates. But I would always look at the curio set because it had even little lights inside of it. And it had dishes and cups and plates. And I would just be like, why can't eat off of that? I want the crystal, right? I want the glistening. And my grandmother would also always say, baby, that's for special use. Do you know God views you like that? Listen, let me tell you a secret. The enemy knows that you are valuable. He knows that. And so what will happen is that we'll have people that come into our lives that want to treat us like we are paper plates and cups. Come on, you ought to say, I'm not a paper plate. Come on. Come on, I'm not no paper plate, amen. You're just going to just bring your junk and dump all this stuff on me and just toss me in the trash. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Amen. I'm a vessel useful. Watch this. He says, for honorable use, what is this word? Set apart as holy. Do you see it? Who is this talking about? Me. Right? Useful to the master of the house, ready for every good work. Now, we're going to deal with the master of the house here in a minute. But let me tell you something about yourself. You are a masterpiece. God says, I want to use you for a very important work. Now, he says, cleanses himself. So I want to give you four keys to cleanse yourself. Number one, you must develop your capacity to hear God's voice. See, as a pastor, a lot of times people will ask questions like this. Well, is it sin if I do this? See, what we've done is we're raising the people that
don't know how to hear God's word, don't know how to understand his word, and don't know how to hear and obey God's voice when the opportunity presents itself. We need to be able to recognize the voice of God. So here it is. Look at this. We can read God's word. We can study his word. We can meditate on his word. We can memorize his word. But this is all so that we can do what? So that we can obey his word. See, I can't be your Holy Spirit. You have to be able to hear God for yourself. Because the Spirit may tell you things that you should not do that not necessarily is considered sin. Right? So the Bible tells us to lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily beset itself. Right? So when we talk about, a lot of times people will say, well, is it sinful for me to do this? Well, have you asked the Holy Spirit? Because I mentioned to you, it's not sinful for me to drink. It's not. But the Bible does teach that I shouldn't drink in excess. But maybe the Holy Spirit tells you, I don't want you to drink at all. You see? Because he knows that you should not do that, because if you do, you can't handle it. Right? So we need to develop our capacity to hear God's voice. Number two, we should discontinue behaviors inconsistent with who we are in Christ. There are just some things that God wants you just to stop doing. Just stop it. Because it's inconsistent with who you are. Number three is that we have to disconnect from bad company. There are just some people that you ever notice, you be doing good until you get around them. Can I talk to the young people right now? It's some kids that you hanging around with right now that's not a good influence on you. How do we know? Because you start saying stuff that they say. I know one time I had said something, and my mama said, now where you get that from? And the Holy Spirit gave her wisdom, because she knew who it was. It's that little boy that over there. I bet you that. I was like, well, you ain't lying. I learned that from him, right? So the Holy Spirit, a lot of times, will tell you disconnect from that individual. See, but the Bible teaches that bad company, what does it do? It corrupts good morals, right? And if you're aiming to be cleansed, some things you just have to just straight up, I got to disconnect from that person. Right? And finally, devote yourself to a lifestyle of prayer and fasting. This will help me to be cleansed. Because there's just some stuff, whether we realize it or not, there's just some stuff that just gets in us that we didn't even realize was there because of what we saw, what we heard, or things that came out of our mouths. Those are our gates. The Bible teaches us to guard, right, our heart. And when we guard our hearts, the way we do that is we guard the things that we are watching. We guard the things that we're listening to, and we guard the stuff that comes out of our mouths, because you'd be surprised how the enemy can whisper thoughts to you and you say it. And when you say it, it's creating this cycle into your heart. So what are we talking about? We're saying our body was not designed solely for our pleasure, but it should be devoted to God's purposes. So we said that the way we present our body for God's purpose is that we see ourselves as sacred. But number two, we maintain a slave mentality. Now, I know you don't like that. Come on, tell your neighbor. Do you have a slave mentality? Yeah, see, nobody like that. Slave mentality. I'm not a slave. How dare you? I'm a son. Yes, you are. But you're also a slave. You don't like that, do you? Well, I'm going to show you the Bible. Watch this. Watch this. He says, you are not your own. If I'm not my own, then who do I belong to? He says, you are not what? Your own. What happened? You were bought with a price. If I was bought with a price, then who was I bought from? That means that before I came to Christ, I belonged to somebody. See, this is why people say, I just couldn't help myself. You were right, because you were a slave. You were enslaved to that thing, and when it came calling, you had to answer. That's why when you saw him calling you, like, you had blocked his number and everything. You had blocked him, deleted him. You had canceled that brother. None of his social media accounts, y'all not following each other, none of that. But when he comes knocking, there you go, you're going to answer anyway. You know why? Because you're a slave to it. See, whether you realize it or not, before Christ, we were all slaves to sin. Look at this. In 1 Corinthians 6, Paul encourages the people. He says, do what? Flee from sexual immorality. The word flee carries this idea of run. Do you hear me? Do you run away from puppies? Well, some of the little kids do. Screaming, right? But you don't run away from cute little things like, oh, it's just so cute. And that's the problem. We don't view sexual immorality as a dangerous threat. We don't realize that it's something we should run from. I love this. Watch this. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the sexual immoral person sins against his own body. Now, listen, we're not going to unpack this. The Holy Spirit said there are some things that he wants you to go back and look at and study out yourself, and this may be one of them. But watch this. It says a sin a person commits is outside the body, but the sexual immoral person commits sins against his own body. Now, it's important. I can't go into all of this, but the scripture says flee fornication in some translations. The word fornication, if you break it down, the Greek word for it is porneia. Porneia is where we get our English term pornography from. If you'll notice, pornography has no limits. I know you're going to sit there and ask spiritual, but you have seen some stuff on pornos that just like, how did they even come up with that? It's because there is a sexual immoral, what's called a sexual immoral continuum, which means that on one end, it's something small and seemingly insignificant, like looking at something that you shouldn't look at. I'm not hurting anybody. It's just me. I'm looking at this, and it's just a little small thing to me. But all the way down on the other end is having sex with animals, having sex with children, pedophilia. See, what we've done in America is we've said, love is love. Let people love who they should love. And can I just be real? That's okay for a sinner man, because this is all they get. If you are a sinner man, you can live it up however you see fit. Do whatever you see that you want to do, but not for the child of God. Why? Because my temple belongs to God. And God doesn't want to be a part of that. And when I go and I have sex with somebody who is not my spouse, I am literally joining the Spirit of God to this mess. Ooh, it's just too deep, too much to get into. But here's what I wanted to say. Sexual immorality is anything that is deviating outside of God's original design for sex. That means that God's design for sex is between one man, help me somebody, and one woman in the context of marriage. That is God's design. Anything outside of that is defiling God's temple. Rated R. I told you it was going to be rated R. Some of you are going to have to go back and explain some of this stuff to your kids. They're going to say, now, Mama, what was he talking about? Sit down and explain it to them. Because what the scripture teaches us is to flee sexual immorality. Now, the Bible talks about a man named Joseph in Genesis 39. I want you to go back and read Genesis 39 about this man named Joseph. Joseph was a young man who was sold into slavery, and he, because the Spirit of God was on him, he had an excellent spirit on him, and as a result, everywhere he went, he started at the bottom and became promoted. Well, he became promoted in this man's house named Potiphar, and the scripture says that Joseph was a very handsome man. You ever got your hair cut and looked in the mirror and were like, oh, what? Yes. I mean, just feeling good about yourself, right? Joseph, the Bible says, was a very handsome man. And so as a result, Potiphar's wife the Bible said, the way the scripture says, cast longing eyes on him. Say, ooh, look at him. And he knew it too. You know when somebody checking you out, like, oh, I see you. Oh, boy. She looking at me again. Oh, no. And the scripture says that she began to apply pressure to him. And she started telling him, won't you sleep with me? Won't you be with me? And here's the question that I had. I said, Lord, how was Joseph able to flee? Because here, let me just give you the real. So I know sometimes we're not real. Joseph is a man that's young. And when you're young and healthy and handsome, there are these feelings that happen on the inside of you. And these feelings that happen make you want to do something like have sex. Oh, you're going to frown at me like, oh, my God, what is he talking about? Yeah, let us give you the remote control at late in the midnight hour. Just scrolling, looking, that stuff. And the scripture says that the way Joseph was able to flee is because he knew he was a slave. Listen to what the scripture says in Genesis 39. In Genesis 39, I'm going to read verse 3 for you because I don't have time to go into any further. It says, his master saw that the Lord was with him. That's all I'm going to say. His master. So in order for the text to refer to Potiphar as Joseph's master must suggest that Joseph saw himself as less than his master, which would be a slave. Now, I want to deal with that word slave for a second. Slave, the word is doulos. Doulos is one who disregards his own interests and gives himself up to another's will. Can I tell you a secret? You are a slave. Because whether you realize it or not, every day you disregard your own interests and you give yourself up to another's will. Now, my question is, to who? Because you will always be a slave to something or someone. Always, 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 every person on earth is a slave to something or someone. The question is, since you will always be a slave to something or someone, the question is not if you are a slave, but to whom are you a slave? Amen. Notice what it says in Romans 6. Do you not know that if you present yourself to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey? Now, when that thing comes knocking and you obey it, you are a slave to it. There are people that are a slave to drugs, slave to alcohol, slave to social media, slave to sex, slave to all kinds of things because you cannot do anything but obey it. So my question is, who are you obeying? Now, I really want to just be very clear and state, yes, we are talking about sexual immorality, but not just sexual immorality. We're talking about how do I steward well this body that God has given to me. So either I will obey sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. Can I make a suggestion? It'll be better for you to be a slave to God, to be a slave to righteousness, than to be a slave of anything else. We're talking about our body was not designed solely for our pleasure, but should be devoted to God's purposes. So we talked about that the way that we present our body for God's purposes, that we must see ourselves as sacred, we must maintain a slave mentality, and thirdly, we must present ourselves as a sacrifice daily. See, when Paul says it like this, he says in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 20, he says, so glorify God in your body. That means that every day I wake up, You know what should be one of my goals in my life? I should say, God, today, my desire is to glorify you. I want to glorify you. And I just want to acknowledge the fact that it's not always easy to do that. But if you could rely on the Holy Spirit, if you can rely on the power of the Holy Spirit, that means that you can glorify God in your body. Now, the word glorify means to praise, extol, to magnify. It's to cause the worth of someone to be made manifest. If worship is me recognizing and responding to God's worth, that means that I can magnify God, I can glorify him because I see him as being worthy of it. Because I see my body as something that he created that's beautiful. Now, notice this. I love this in Romans 12. It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to do what? Present your bodies as what? A living sacrifice. This idea of presenting means that this is on your own terms. You did this because you wanted to. As a living sacrifice, holy and what? Acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed, how? By the renewing of your mind, that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. I love this quote by a theologian called John Stott. He says, stewarding our bodies is not just about physical health. It is about aligning our desires, our thoughts, and actions with God's will. I promise you, people that are living in a way that doesn't glorify God in their bodies is not asking God, what is your will? And that's what we should be asking. God, what is your will? Look at this. It is a holistic pursuit of honoring God in what? Every aspect of our being. As we wrap up today, family, I want to encourage you that Jesus glorified God in his body. And Jesus is the best example that we have of what does that look like to glorify God in his body. The scripture says that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, that he prayed. And as he prayed, he said, God, if there is any way possible for me, let this cup pass. He said, but nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Because he understood that God created him so that he could glorify God with his body. And the way he glorify God with his body as he gave it God to God for God's purposes, that God could sacrifice it for our sins. And if there's anyone here today that hasn't made Jesus Lord of your life, if this message was hard for you and it's just difficult and say, well, what about this? And I got these challenges. Well, I want to invite you today to make Jesus Lord of your life. The scripture says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, that you would be saved. And I'm going to tell you something, that God wants to use our bodies to bring him glory. And while it may not be easy, it is doable, because the Spirit of God will empower us to do it. Now, something that I want to invite you to do is that if you made Jesus Lord of your life, but if you haven't, cleansed yourself, you haven't confessed sin, you haven't been on the right track, I want to invite you to be restored. Pray. And as we get ready to conclude our service, I want to do something kind of different. She's going to give us a few practical ideas and steps as it relates to. Because I think many of us, we may have dealt with spiritual, dealt with sexual.
Still morning, right? Okay. Hello, family. Thank you, Pastor T and Lady Cindy, for the opportunity to speak with you all. I'm just going to keep it very general. We've heard a great message by our pastor, and let's give that a round of applause. Something that was needed to be said, and I'm glad the children have an opportunity to hear this as well, and parents definitely. You know, you may have to go home and speak to your children, but this is what it's for. So let me introduce myself really quickly. My name is Charvelle Jones, but I affectionately go by Dr. Jones when I'm in the office. I'm a licensed chiropractor and massage therapist. My office is located near NRG area. So we provide chiropractic care, massage, physical therapy, things that need to help heal the body. And I say that name very strongly and passionately because the name of my business is Heal Thy Body Wellness Center. And I have to give the appreciation and the kudos and the love that my aunt, Deborah Campbell, was the one who came up with that name, Heal Thy Body. She had me write it on a piece of paper. She'd say, write down the word heal. And I wrote it down, H-E-A-L. And she'd say, now write the word thy. And I wrote down the word, T-H-Y, and she said, now put it together. What does it spell? And I went, healthy. What? Blew my mind. The woman is phenomenal, okay? And from that point on, it birthed the name of my business and has been to this day for almost 20 years. So living a healthy life is very difficult. Pastor T just gave us a great message on the temple, and that it's not our own. So if we had an opportunity, you know, we have ways, like he said, we misuse it. Gluttony, sexual immorality, overeating, the substance abuse. But when you think about living a healthier life, you got to think about mentally, of course, spiritually, but physically, okay? So let's look at the mental. The mental here is in a manner relating to the what? The mind. So give me an example about mental. What could we do to stimulate our mental? Somebody? Play games? Okay. Yes. Anybody else have something? Read? Okay, what else? Okay, read? Okay. So it's something that can stimulate the mind. Meditate, yes, okay. So those are things we can do for our mental. Now, what can we do spiritually? So spiritually is the recognition of a feeling or a sense, or of a feeling or sense or belief that is something greater than myself. So what can we do spiritually? Pray. Worship, we're here, thank you. We're here now, what else? Act on the word, very good. Act on the word, reading our Bibles, okay, very good. So that's spiritually, and I put it in the middle here because you say mind, body, spirit, but I put it in the middle because the next one is physical. Lastly, in a matter relating to the body, I put it in the middle because spiritually, we can be centered, okay? Our mind is here, our full body here, but spiritually. So in the body, let's give the body some attention because like Pastor T said, we can misuse it. Oh, I mean, I wanted that donut, but I'm on a little cleanse and I just had to just refrain from that donut. But when we think about a healthier physical life, let me pose this question to you. So how many in here go for their regular checkups? Okay, all right. Get your checkups, follow-ups, okay. Now who in here gets some pain or some discomfort and immediately go to the doctor? I thought it was going to be less hands. That's okay. There's no judgment here. I said that for a reason, because we typically don't give our bodies the attention that it really needs sometimes. Oh, it'll pass. I'll be okay. Oh, that's not going to stop me. I got other things to do. I got little ones I got to take care of. I got to get to work. So we don't think about taking care of our physical right off top. Okay, so it's important that we do so. Let me just give you some little tips about living physically, a good physical life. So, of course, eating right, eating the right foods, fruits, vegetables, lean meats, that could be chicken, turkey, whatever, fish. I'm more of a plant-based person, okay? But it's whatever your cup of tea is. And let me say this right off top. Everybody's body is different. Everybody's consumption is different. Everybody's needs are different. So don't think that you have to look at somebody and say, oh, I'm gonna eat a salad. Oh, she eating a salad, I'm eating a salad. No, you may need some protein, you know? She's eating all of this fish and turkey and she's not eating beef or pork. Well, then I may, no, because your body may need the protein, different types of protein and the amount of protein. So it's okay. No judgment, okay? So eating would be good. Hydration. Who in here drinks enough water? We live in Texas, y'all. Houston, Texas, okay? You drinking enough water? I wasn't. Let me be transparent. I don't. I'm going to be transparent. And we talked about sexual immorality. I don't like to go to the restroom everywhere, so I don't want to have to drink a whole lot of water where I have to stop and go, am I the only one? I'm the only one? Okay, I didn't think I was. So my water intake may not be the best throughout the day like it should be. But we need to hydrate. And it's not so much it has to be water, pure water, because it's boring. But we can get it from our fruits and vegetables. We can get it from coconut water. I love coconut. I'm getting ready to go on vacation, and I can't wait. So to partake in some coconut. But hydration, reducing processed foods and sugars. I know y'all had them donuts back there, but you know what? I may have to donate to the church some. We may not do those bananas because I'm still traumatized over those bananas. But those processed foods and sugars, we need to eliminate or reduce. Now, let me also input this. God made everything, right? We know he made everything that's on this earth was made by God, right? Okay, but it's when we take things and put them together that should not be together that can be harmful for our bodies, okay? So the processed food, so he made the sugar, yes, he made the flour and all of that, but putting all that stuff together, you got a good old cake. You got a good old cookie, okay? Maybe not the healthiest, okay? So reducing your processed foods and sugars. And also now exercising. So I know it's hot in Texas. Getting out and walking and biking, maybe you have to do it 10 o'clock at night. It's just too early to be doing it. You know, you can't do this at 7 or 6 at p.m. because it's still too hot. But getting out and getting some physical exercise. If you work in an office building and you have 10 flights of stairs and your level is at the fifth level, maybe try taking the stairs, taking an elevator part way, and then taking the stairs up the other part, and vice versa, okay? Kids, y'all do enough of running around. Y'all expel a lot of energy. I'm talking to the grown folks on this one, okay? The kids, y'all get enough energy. Like Pastor T said, them kids coming to the house, you know they there, okay? Because they'll run wild. But exercising, dancing, playing tennis, playing basketball, something, get out there and get some physical activity. Get that blood pumping, okay? Got a couple more points. And then sleep. So how many here get 8 hours of sleep? 10? 12? Oh, I'm going the wrong way. Oh, okay. Let me back up then. So 6? 4? Okay, about 4? Who in here get 1? 1 hour? You know. Okay, he gets 1 hour. I'm going to give it to him. He gets 1 hour of sleep, okay? But I said that to say, because our bodies need to rest. This is how we restore our bodies, when it's at rest. We cannot function on borrowed energy. So therefore, we need to stop, take a nap. I'm not a nap person. I'm gonna be transparent. I'm not a nap person, because if I take a nap in the middle of the day, I'm not going to sleep late at night, okay? So taking naps if you need to can help. I'm also inject this also too, your vitamins. Taking your vitamins. I just recently been reinvigorated about the use of vitamin D3. How many here have gone to the doctors and their doctors probably prescribed them some D3s and stuff? Because a large percentage of us are deficient, because if we are not outdoors, we don't get the natural vitamin D. So we need to ingest it. And one little tip, if you do decide to get vitamin D tablets or any of those gel tablets, try to take it with the meal, because it is a fat-soluble vitamin and it does not dissolve in water. So taking water is almost like a moot point. It's not gonna move in a body and absorb in a body. So take it with a full fat, something, you know, nutritional type of food, salmon or something like that. You know, maybe not the chicken nuggets or any of that, but whatever your meal is, okay? Like I said, no judgment, people. But make sure that you're taking your vitamins. Also magnesium, if you need to rest, that is the chill pill vitamin, okay? Magnesium is good to help relax that mind, turn off that brain. Mine don't turn off. I stay clicking. But I need something to calm me down and take away the ease of, you know, take away the day and ease me out. So magnesium is good, okay? So make sure you're getting enough sleep. And the amount of hours may vary from person to person. If you need 8 hours, get your 8 hours. If you can function on six, function on six. Function on four. But long as you're letting your body rest, okay? And lastly here, going back to the first thing, the question I asked you about, getting regular checkups. Our bodies talk to us. When that ache and pain come, when that discomfort comes, when that crick in your neck or something happened and, you know, something in the back, that is your body telling you something is not right. It may not be all that bad, but it's something that needs to be addressed. And I always tell my patients, treat your body or treat the injury in the phase that it's in. So if it's fairly new, go get it checked out. Because it's easier for the doctor to diagnose and help it out early. If you wait, oh, doc, I've been having this for like 10 years. What? 10 years? I love the show Dr. Pimple Popper. And I'll see these people, and there's no judgment on them, but I'll see these people with this big growth. They say, I had it for 15 years. 15 years? But I understand that some people are afraid of the doctor. That's why I'm bringing that up about going to get checkups and follow-ups. Some people are afraid of the doctors, and it's okay. I'm a good doctor. I'm the first portal entry doctor. I don't prescribe any meds. I don't prescribe any, I don't do any surgery. I take my natural, my hands, chiro means hand. I take my hands and I deliver a movement, a maneuver that will help release any type of discomfort that is going on in your body. So if you've never had a chiropractic treatment or visit and you would love to, my information is there. That's fine, but I wanted to also point this out here. You see that slogan? When you heal thy body, it becomes a healthy body. Thank you, Deborah Campbell, Auntie. I love her. And lastly, you only get one body. Take care of it. You only get one body. If I could take your head off, I'm sorry, I don't mean to be graphic, and put another body on top of it, hey, I'll be a millionaire and I'll be somewhere in some island or whatever, just replacing bodies. But you only get one body, so take care of it the best that you can, okay? That's it, that's all I have, yes. We had a question. Oh, that's a good question, okay. And this was a shameless plug. I mean, I had to tell you all who I am to be qualified to come up here and speak on some of this. But yes, I only take one insurance. I'm sorry, because the insurance company is kind of crazy right now. I only take Blue Cross Blue Shield, but I do have a cash service that comparable to that Starbucks coffee that you add up every for a month. Just reduce some of that, okay? And it can come out to that. But yes, insurance, I do only take Blue Cross Blue Shield. That's the only one for right now. So, but if you feel free to reach out to me, my website is there. You can take a look, whatever it is, any information, or I could just, or you just give me a call, okay? That's it. Thank you.
Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Dr. Jones. We really appreciate that. And thank each of you for spending a little extra time with us today. We thought it would be important to share about the temple, the body, and how we treat it. And so we're grateful for each of you. And so we just want to close out. Let's close out with a word of prayer. And I ask that you would stand. Praise God. Amen. Thank you so much for being here today. Praise God. Let us pray. Father, we are thankful today for, God, just the time that we've been able to spend in this sermon series, God, on the heart of worship. And Lord, our desire, Father, is that we would worship you, Father, in spirit and in truth, that, Lord, we'll worship you with the totality of who we are, spirit, soul, and body, that our entire person would be used to bring you glory, God, and that we would magnify your name, Lord, as we live for you. And God, we thank you, Father, that we'll steward these temples well. Lord, that we'll listen to our bodies, Father, that we'll do the things that are needed from a natural standpoint so that, God, we'll be capable, Lord, to carry out the call and assignment on our lives today, Father. We love you. We thank you today. We give you praise, glory, and the honor today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. If you would turn to someone next to you, in front of you, behind you, tell them, I see you. Come on, tell someone else, I see you. God sees you. And God loves you. The things I desire for my family. Long life. Health. Wealth. Favor. I desire for you. This week, be encouraged. Remember, our bodies are to bring God glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, family.
Can you shout it out one more time? I'm expecting great things. Expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. Great things.
That's real simple right there. Can you help me declare it over your life? Say,
I'm expecting great things. Great things. I'm expecting great things.